Now, those of you who have watched Quentin Tarantino's Inglourious Basterds or Giuseppe Tornatore's Nuovo Cinema Paradiso would clearly recall how integral to the plot were the use of reels and projection rooms. In Inglourious Basterds, the character Shoshana, played by the versatile Melanie Laurent, uses the nitrate reels to burn down an entire cinema hall to assassinate Adolf Hitler. While in Cinema Paradiso, the character Alfredo, played by Philippe Noiret, loses his eyesight in the mishap triggered by the combustible nitrate reels. Despite the availability of the relatively safer acetate reels since 1908, audiences preferred nitrate films for their compactness and image clarity. However, these reels were highly inflammable, difficult to douse, and could even burn under water. This state of affairs continued till 1951, when nitrate reels were finally supplanted by acetate reels. I often marvel at how one single discovery gave humans their greatest mode of entertainment and destruction in one go. A film that could capture artists' imagination was also the microcosm of the destructive powers of its base material, celluloid. In 1838, French chemist Anselm Payen isolated a vital structural component of the primary cell wall of green plants and named it cellulose. This discovery revolutionized the arms and ammunition race, leading to the manufacturing of gun cotton and dynamite, and also laid the foundation for plastic industry. In 1862, a British inventor patented his version of thermoplastic that involved the mixing of nitric acid to cellulose in the presence of a solvent. He called his invention Parkesine. In the 1860s, the US-based Hayat brothers bought the rights to Parkesine and began developing their own version of thermoplastics to replace ivory as the primary raw material in the manufacture of billiard balls. They patented their discovery as celluloid in 1872. This formed the base for the first nitrate films manufactured by Eastman Kodak in 1889. As celluloid was the fundamental ingredient in film manufacturing, the reels came to be interchangeably called celluloid. And that's how cinema came to be called celluloid. In the late 1950s, a bespectacled man was strolling through the dingy by lanes of a scrap market in Kolkata. He stopped by at a dealer's place where tins of rotting reels were accumulating. While sifting through the collection, he came across a set of reels that seemed promising. His trained eyes jumped to attention when he realized what he was holding. Could it be true, he thought. If he was indeed holding what he thought was, it meant a great find. For he knew that the negatives of the film in his hands had been destroyed in a fire, and the spare reels had been taken to Pakistan after partition. India did not have a copy of the most critically acclaimed piece of art coming from its tinsel town. He immediately paid the scrap dealer ₹100 and bought the reels. If it were not for this chance encounter, the scrap dealer would have burned the reels to collect the residual silver. The bespectacled man was Subrato Mitra, the cinematographer friend of Satyajit Ray. Mitra had helmed camera for Ray's Pathaner Panchali and is credited with pioneering the camera art of bounce lighting. Mitra was ecstatic on realizing the value of his find. He contacted the National Film Archives of India and deposited the reels with them. The reels belonged to Chetan Anand directed Nijanagar, the only Indian film till date to have won the Grand Prix, or as it is known today, Palme d'Or, at the International Cannes Film Festival. Nijanagar happens to be the film that inspired Satyajit Ray to take up directing seriously. Incidentally, it was Nijanagar that sent Ray to the sets of John Renoir's The River, where he met Subrato Mitra. But that's a story for another time. Nijanagar was the directorial debut of Chetan Anand, the elder brother of actor Dev Anand. This also was the debut of a majority of actors, including Kamini Kaushal, Rafiq Anwar as protagonist Balraj, Zora Sehgal, Chetan Anand's wife Uma, and also Pandit Ravi Shankar as the music composer. Inspired by Russian writer Maxim Gorky's play The Lower Depths, Nichanagar juxtaposes two localities, Unchanagar and Nichanagar. Unchanagar is the place where the high and the mighty live, drag on their imported cigars, sip on the exotic brews and eat in silverware, attended on by a retinue of servants, all the while looking down upon the residents of Nichanagar, whose destinies and fortune the rich write. The story is about a shrewd and rapacious businessman from Unchanagar named Sarkar, played by Rafiq Peer, who wants to drain a swamp to make way for residential high-rises. To effect his scheme, he plans to channel the water through Nichanagar, ignoring the catastrophic effect such a devious plan would have on the residents of the poor locality. Sarkar uses subversion, coercion, and deviousness to divide his quarry, even as he sugarcoats his venom. Catastrophe soon strikes as the filthy water becomes the breeding ground of various diseases. When the residents of Nichanagar start dying, Sarkar in his magnanimity establishes a hospital. However, the villagers see through Sarkar's deviousness, with Balraj turning into their moral and spiritual leader. When Balraj falls prey to a disease, it's Sarkar's daughter Maya, played by Uma Anand, the love interest of Balraj in the cinema, who takes over the fight. Nichanagar was many things combined into one. It was an amalgamation of an unrelenting pursuit of excellence, a documentary of human suffering under an alien power hell-bent on maximizing its profits, a satirical take on diplomatic exercises being nothing more than masked passive aggression. A seminal work that would go on to inspire generation of auteurs to take on the powers that be without fear or favor. An allegory of the British oppression, aided and abetted by profiteers. That Chetan was allowed to complete the filming and was even given the censor board's approval speaks highly of his ability to hide complexity in the bosom of the story that was adapted to the Indian context by Hayatullah Ansari. The dialogues were crafted by Khwaja Ahmad Abbas. Nichanagar was produced by Rafiq Anwar, who took some of the reels and negatives to Pakistan after partition. The shooting began in 1945 and was sent to the inaugural edition of the Cannes Film Festival in 1946 as India's official entry. There it won the Grand Prix with 10 other movies. Interestingly, a majority of the films that won the top honors were anti-imperialist and anti-colonial in their tone and tenor. The reason could be that Cannes in itself was an act of protest. When the first annual international film festival was inaugurated at Venice in Italy in 1932, the country was in the vice-like grip of the fascist Benito Mussolini. A couple of years into the festival, the participants understood that only Nazi and fascist propagandists were likely to take home the Mussolini Cup, which was later christened as the Golden Lion. It was in protest of this partisan selection that French bureaucrats and ministers decided to start their own festival. Cannes was selected as the venue, and September 1, 1939 was the date set for inauguration. However, on that very day, Nazi Germany invaded Poland to start the Second World War, and the festival was called off. The festival resumed in 1946, after the World War ended. For a film that was well received abroad, Nichanagar found it difficult to even find a release in India. The fact that Chetan Anand refused to compromise to the demands of box office did not help matters either. There's not a single love song or a romantic song in the entire cinema, and this was enough to keep the viewers away. It was only after Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru intervened that the distributors relented to give slots for Neet Nagar's theatrical release. But the audience, on its part, refused to have anything to do with an art cinema. Neet Nagar, for all its global exposure and acclaim, was a miserable failure in its homeland. And with that died the hopes of Chetan Anand to be the trailblazer in the world of Indian cinema. The wannabe torchbearer of India's neo-realism died a sudden death. Probably he should have paid heed to what Anton Chekhov had to say to Maxim Gorky in 1902 after reading the play The Lower Depths. Chekhov says, "The tone is gloomy, oppressive. The audience, unaccustomed to such subjects, will walk out of the theatre, and you may well say goodbye to your reputation as an optimist." After the failure of Neet Nagar in its homeland, Chetan was considered a non-bankable director, unsafe and also a bit dangerous. To get work again, he had to make compromises. From wanting to adhere to realism in cinema, he had to embrace commercialism. After tasting further defeats in his directorial ventures Afsar and Andhiyan, Lady Luck finally smiled on him when his noir film Taxi Driver became a hit. In 1964, it was a watershed moment in his career when the granddaddy of all Indian war films, Haqeeqat, was released. Later, his 1966 cinema Aakhri Khat showed what genuine craft meant when he let loose a toddler in Bombay and followed him with a handheld camera to record the travails and tribulations tinged with compassion. His moderate success was soon forgotten, and his greatest achievement turned into a mere footnote in the history of world cinema. Only a trivia, invoked to floor an opponent, for chances are high that none has heard about Neet Nagar or its Palme d'Or. Talking about trivia, Aakhri Khat predates Baby's Day Out by a quarter of a century. And yes, Aakhri Khat was Rajesh Khanna's debut film.